Indeed, indeed, indeed. Every praise, every praise, every praise belongs to our God. Good evening, Radio Land. This is Jen Harvey, your host, for this evening segment of the Hour of Power. Indeed, I have a powerful word for you. A word that has power resident in it, because it is the word of God. But if you do nothing with it, it will do nothing with you. So we have got to take the word of God. We have to mix it and mingle it with faith. And then we must act upon it. And it will yield us the results that God intended for it to yield us. Once more, this is Jen Harvey, your host for the Hour of Power from the Bible Says International Ministries. And it is a ministry where we proclaim the whole counsel of God. Just a few announcements before we begin our teaching for this evening. The Bible Says International Ministries Second Women's Brunch Symposium is fast arriving. It is slated for October 14th from 10 a.m. until 3 p.m. The plans are being made. Everything is being put in place. And it is going to be an absolutely glorious time. As we worship and praise before the Lord, we will fellowship and we will praise and we will worship and we will feast. And registration is $25, $20 if you register early, $25 if you register through Eventbrite or you have passed the early registration phase. I'm going to be telling you in the upcoming 2 weeks as we open registration. And everything else is absolutely free. Mark your calendar. Tell a person. This is an evangelistic appeal. God can only save a person when they hear the word of God. The Bible says, how can they believe when they have not heard? You can't pray a person into the faith. The person must hear the word of God and accept it via faith. How can they believe when they have not heard? The scripture says, and how can they hear when a preacher has not been sent? And God has sent his servant, Jen Harvey. And week after week, you hear me make this evangelistic appeal. The days are short ahead of us. Our soon returning King is going to burst these skies. And then it is going to be too late shall be the cry. Please tell others to join Choice and listen in on Choice Radio Station. There is something here for everyone. There's musical ministration. There's the word. There's preaching. There is teaching. There is something here for everyone. Please share the station information and then encourage others to come and learn about the God that you have been learning about, the God who has been kind and gracious to you and I. Don't keep the good message, the good news to yourself. Amen. I want to thank each and every person who have tuned in Friday after Friday, week after week, to listen to the Hour of Power. And there are many things that are pulling you, and you have other things that you could have given your time to. So Jen Harvey, on behalf of Choice Radio Station and the Bible Says International Ministries, just want to let you know how much we appreciate your time and thank you very much. May the Lord richly bless you. Let us now open with prayers. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. Lord, we bless you, we praise you, we worship you, we magnify your name. We thank you because you are such an awesome God. We thank you because you are a loving Father. We thank you because you are a friend who sticks closer than a brother. We thank you because we can count on you. We thank you because you are our ever-present help in times of trouble. We thank you because you will not leave us orphan. You have not left us orphan. We thank you because you will not reject us, O God, but that we can come boldly to the throne room of grace. We can lay our problems before you. We can share our heart before you. And we know that you will not laugh at us. We know that you will not take it and tell it to the whole world. We know that whatever counsel you give us is upright, is godly, and is meant to make us better. Father, as we are about to break the bread of life, you said that man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. Spirit of the living God, we invite you into our midst. Spirit of the living God, I hide behind the cross. I pray that you will speak through me, Spirit of the living God. Speak that which will touch the hearts of your people. Speak that which is powerful and has the power to change their lives if they receive it joyfully. Father, I thank you. I pray that your word will have free course in the name of Jesus. I come against every arrow that has been shot out against me or your people. Every arrow of doubt, every arrow of weariness, every arrow of unbelief, every arrow of tiredness. Father, I come against it in the name of Jesus. I come against it with the blood of Jesus. I come against it with the fire of the Holy Ghost. I command arrows to return to sender in the name of Jesus. Oh God, every evil word that has been spoken against your people, oh God, I pull it out of the spirit realm in the name of Jesus. I trample it underfoot. I decree null and void. I decree the powers of darkness, their powers. I decree that they are ineffective and harmless against your people. Spirit of the living God, do what only you can do in our lives. Do what eyes haven't seen. Do what ears haven't heard. Do what has never even entered into our own hearts. And we will be careful to give you the praise. Move mountains, O God. O God, move Goliaths from before us in the mighty name of Jesus. Give us the boldness, O God, to stand on your words and on your promises. And having done all, to stand. In Jesus' mighty precious name we pray, and let the church say amen. Welcome to the Hour of Power, and I am your host, Jen Harvey, from the Bible Says International Ministries. Today I have a very special teaching. God desires us to lead a balanced Christian life. There are those who are excellent in prayers and others who have a profound understanding of the Word of God. Several years ago, God spoke to me concerning what He shared with me called the 50-50 principle. This is what He told me. Tell my people, as it relates to the areas of prayers and the word, they must not allow one to suffer at the expense of the other. They must be equally proficient. If you don't know the word, you cannot pray effectively. And if you understand the word but refuse to use it as a mighty weapon of defense, then what good is it? Hence, we are going to get into the word of God and allow the word of God to get into us. For those who are churched, you might very well be familiar with the story of the woman with the issue of blood. For those who are not, this will be your introductory course. The story is found in all three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and it is also found in the book of John. Now, the book of Matthew, Mark, and Luke are known as the Synoptic Gospels, and they are called accordingly because the same stories are found in all three Gospels. But today we are going to be reading from the book of Mark. And the topic for my teaching today is the purposeful touch. The purposeful touch. And we're going to be reading from Mark chapter 5, verses 25 through 34. Here begins the reading of God's holy writ. And a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all she had, and was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse, when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, "If I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole." And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said unto him, "Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, Who touched me?" And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him, and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, "Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace, and be whole of thy plague." Here ends the reading of God's holy word. Let us glean principles from these verses that can be applied to our daily lives. For the word of God and the principles by which he governs himself and his creations are steadfast. They are unchanging, immutable, irrevocable. So they are indisputable, they are irreversible, they are permanent, and they are unalterable. There should not be any confusion as to how God operates. For the Bible says that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. The reason why there is so much confusion is that many Christians have not truly studied the Word of God, asking the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is the final authority. He is one of the Godhead, and he is the final authority on the Word of God for us here on earth. It is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. He's the third person of the triune God. The triune God being equal in plan, equal in purpose, and equal in power. Principles 1. The first principle I'd like to share with you is that we must approach the Father with faith. We must approach the Father with faith. Now, Hebrews 11 verses 6. But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. How do we know this scripture is true in the verses or the story that we have read earlier? Verse 48 tells us, "And he said unto her," he being Jesus, "and he said unto her, Daughter, be of good comfort, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace." There's something I wanted to point out in verse 28. "For she said, If I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole." Was she made whole? Yes, she was. But who did she say it to? The very intent of her heart was granted unto her. Nothing is hidden from the Lord, for he searches the heart and the mind. Just as Jesus is aware of private sins, so too he's aware of private faith. She first settled it in her heart and made the determination that, "I know the crowd is thick, and I am forbidden by Mosaic laws to be out and about, but I do not need to touch him. I need only to touch the hem of his garment, and I will be made whole." She did not say she would be made well. Sometimes there are many people who have diseases of all sorts, and they may be on medications that have not cured their diseases, but rather there are treatment, And some days they feel well, but they still have that disease. But she said, if I touched but the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. Principle number two, faith without works is dead. When she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind him and touched his garment. For she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be made whole. First, she heard. What she heard stirred faith in her heart. This caused her to get up, and she sought after the Master. May I ask, what is it you're listening to? Or who is it you're listening to? If what you hear is not godly, you must reject it. Do not harbor it in your heart. If what you hear is godly and relevant to your situation, why have you not acted upon it? What are you waiting for? There are many blessings that are built on this truth that faith without works is dead. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Do you want to increase your faith? Get into the word of God. Get the word of God into you. Get into a Bible-believing church where the word of God, the unadulterated word of God, is being taught, where it is being preached. Seek the Holy Spirit's help to practice the things you have learned from scriptures, to practice the things that you have learned that were taught to you. When you see God move on your behalf because you have obeyed, it will catapult your faith. It will catapult your faith. So you must hear. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. If faith is built from hearing the word of God, then I can turn that statement around, and the opposite is also true. Faithlessness comes from not hearing the word of God. Principle number three, approach the Lord. Approach the governor of the galaxies. Approach Jesus with reverence. We must approach our Lord and our Savior and our Master with reverence. The Bible says when the woman saw that she was not hid, she came trembling and falling down before him. Many of us have not received because we were not taught how to approach our Heavenly Father and how to lay our petitions before him. He's the God of all mercies, but he's also the God of protocol. He's not a bellhop. He's not our errand boy. He's not a genie in a bottle, which we rub and our wishes are granted. He's the God of the universe. He's the God of all flesh, and of such he must be reverenced. Principle number four, do not despise biblically acceptable conventional means. Do not despise biblically acceptable conventional means. Jesus did not rebuke her from having sought the help of many physicians. Saints, go to the doctor. Take care of your temple. But while you go to the doctor, still depend on Jesus. Still depend on the power of the Holy Spirit to work through physicians. I am in the healthcare arena, and I must tell you this, and I tell you with all truth. The medical model is disease-oriented. The medical model is not preventative-oriented. You and I must learn to take care of our temples. Doctors were taught to treat diseases. Doctors were not schooled on preventing diseases in terms of health prevention. They are not. Some are. But for the most part, they are not very, very knowledgeable on preventative medicine. Our country spends very little money on preventative medicine. The bulk of health care is spent on disease, treatment of diseases, the disease-oriented model that we have in this country. This is why I do not call it, for the most part, health care, because it is not health care as the word or the phrase says, health care. It is sickness care. It is disease care. It is up to you and I to take care of our temples before we get to the place of disease. I'm going to say it again. It is up to you and I to take care of this temple before we get to the place of disease, because you will give an account to God, as I also must give an account to God when he asks you, what did you do with the temple I gave you? Meaning or bodies. We must take care of it. There is information. We are living in the time where technology is at our fingertip, and there are information, an insurmountable amount of information. We go and we Google everything else. We are on Facebook wasting our times. We are on Instagram wasting our lives. We have to start using our time wisely. Go and research. The onus of your health is not to your healthcare provider. It is up to you. I am going to share this truth with you, that most people, not only Christian, but most people don't know, or they don't understand, or they're not privy to. You and I are not responsible. We're not only responsible for what we know. Most people think we're only responsible for what we know. It gets deeper than that. We are responsible for what is available to us, whether you know it or not. If it is available, you are responsible for it. Let me tell you why. Diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, which is high cholesterol, HIV, cancers, they don't care if you know that they exist. If your body creates the right environment, the right medium for them, they will live in you, whether you know that they exist or not, or whether you know that you have the disease or not. So it behooves you and I to take care of our health, because the information is available. Saints, take care of your temple. It is the only one you have on this side in the land of the living. Let us take care of our temple. Principle number 5, God is still in the business of healing. I am going to repeat that. God is still in the business of healing. I know that there are many faiths that think that healing, divine healing, has ceased. It has not. God has physicians and other healthcare practitioners available through information, through technology, through studies. They're there to help. But God is still in the business of healing, for he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. He's still in the business of healing both emotionally, spiritually, and physiologically. He's still in the business of healing. Do not allow a long-standing issue to cause you to give up and accept your situation or your condition as a way of life. This woman suffered rejection, poor health, pain, both physically and emotionally. Financially, she was broke. She bore a social stigma, but she said in verse 28, "For she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole." It may be a month, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, or beyond. Know this, accept no less than that which God has spoken about your situation and your circumstances. He's still in the business of healing and restoration. Let me share this with you. A lot of people ask God to heal them and they don't see any answer to their prayers. Many people do not believe that God can heal them. That's the lack of faith. That's one thing. And many people speak with their mouths that they want to be healed, but their action says another thing. Now, it is impossible for you to truly believe that God can heal you, for you to truly think you want to be healed, and the very thing that brings disease upon you, you continue to walk in those paths. I'm going to repeat it, because that's a direct reflection of, one, your lack of faith, or that you truly don't want to be healed. You cannot have diabetes. You cannot have hypertension. You cannot be obese, and you're asking God to heal you, and you're eating every day at the Chinese restaurant. You're eating every day at McDonald's. You refuse to get up and exercise. You open your refrigerator and all there is soda and drinks and cookies and candies. And then at night you're asking God to heal you of your diabetes. Foolishness. You're asking God to heal you of your hypertension. Foolishness. You're asking God to help you in terms of the obesity-induced illnesses, and you continue in the paths. Foolishness. Jen Harvey told God, and God instructed me to declare the whole counsel, whether people like it or whether they don't. Declare the whole counsel of God. For my people, the Bible says, they are destroyed because of lack of knowledge. And it is not because knowledge is not available. It is because they have rejected it. I said it earlier. You are responsible not only for what you know, but for what is available. So if you have hypertension, you start reading, you start going on the internet, you start reading about hypertension, you start looking at a diet that is suitable for you. No quick fixes, no foolish diets, but a diet that is suited for your health condition. It is foolishness for you and I to appear before the Lord asking him to heal us of a particular disease, of a particular condition, yet we continue to walk in the things that created our illnesses. Isn't that absurd? So I can tell you, stop praying and asking God to heal you of your diabetes, and you're still eating all those candy, all those white bread, all those soda, McDonald's, the Chinese restaurant. You are wasting your time. It is not going to happen. it is not going to happen. Because your very act of eating carelessly, your very act of not paying attention to your health, tells God, I do not want to be healed. Remember, when it comes to words and when it comes to actions, your actions takes precedence over your word. Your actions takes precedence over your words. Have you seen people who can quote scriptures, who can say this and say that? They're speaking, but you must look at their lifestyle. That's the true them. When your spoken word is not in concert with your actions takes precedence over your spoken words. So if you truly want to be healed, you would be saying, Lord, I am trying, help me. And you will change your lifestyle. You will change your diet. You will start getting up and getting some exercises. You will start reading. Once you start doing those things and you're asking the Holy Spirit to help me and you're getting into the Word of God, it may very well be that God will show up. As a matter of fact, I want to share this with you, being a healthcare provider. Many of the diseases that we have, they're lifestyle induced. Once we change our lifestyles, the diseases will go. Oh, I just saved you years of sickness and years of money running to the physician. Most of the diseases that we have, they're lifestyle induced. If we change our lifestyle, the diseases will go. Principle number 6, share your testimony with all around you. Share your testimony with all around you. For they overcame him, Satan, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Luke 8 verses 47b. I like Luke's version more than Mark's because it hits a home run in support of my point. Hear what it says. And when the woman saw that she was not hid, she came trembling, and falling down before him, she declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. When God does something for us, we should share it. We should share our testimony because we don't know what others are going through around us. It may be a word that is due in season to a weary soul. It may be that there are others around us just going through the same thing. Others may be struggling in their faith, questioning God's ability, questioning God's wherewithal to help them. So when you share it, they say, if God can do it for Jen Harvey, if God can do it for Tom, if God can do it for Mary, and God can do it for Steve, then certainly God can do it for me. It is imperative that we share our testimonies with others around us. When you share your testimony with others, they too can become strengthened. They too will desire to know your God. They in turn will share it with others. And I told you previously, for they overcame him, him being Satan, by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of their testimonies. Principle number 7. Jesus is touched and acquainted by our infirmities. That's what makes him the great high priest. That's what makes him the great physician. That's what makes him the great intercessor. Hebrews 4 verses 15. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Mark 5 verses 30 says, "And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, 'Who touched my clothes?'" We don't serve a hit or miss God. Amen. Jesus knew that the virtue of healing had gone out of him, for her purposeful touch was one of healing, one she discussed with none. Yet, when the fingers of faith touched the Father's fringes on his garment, God knew exactly what she needed, and he provided it through his Son, Jesus Christ. And he provided it according to his riches in glory through Christ Jesus. Jesus is touched by our infirmities, saints. He knows our every suffering. He knows it. All to Jesus surrender. All to him freely give. Give him everything. He is here and he's waiting. He's waiting to take it from us. But we must give it to him. We must go boldly to the throne room of grace. We must know that we serve a loving God. We must know that we serve a faithful Father. We must know that he is a true friend. He's waiting. He's touched by your infirmities. He's touched by my infirmity. Principle number 8. You and I, we must discard the status quo set outside of the boundaries and step outside of the boundaries of limitation. We must discard the status quo. We must discard what is conventional and step outside. If there is a status quo, if there is a protocol that sets limit on you for what God can do for you, we must step outside of that, the boundaries of limitation. Here's a woman who had gotten to the point of no turning back. She had spent all she had, and she was none better, the Bible says. The Bible says she had suffered much at the hands of many physicians for 12 years. And I know that there may be some that's under the sound of my voice who can relate to this woman. In the era she lived, she was labeled unclean based on Mosaic laws. She was not allowed in public gatherings. Even a husband, if she had one, was not allowed to be in close proximity to her. Her condition could be made comparable to that of a leper. She could be stoned to death if she purposefully violated the Mosaic laws by venturing out of the boundaries placed upon her by those laws. But she took a godly leap of faith and stepped outside of the boundaries that barricaded her from receiving her blessings. She stepped outside of those boundaries. She stepped outside of those boundaries that barricaded her from receiving her blessings. Principle number 9. Jesus is not subject to the laws, for he is the fulfillment of the laws. Jesus is not subject to the laws, for he is the fulfillment of the law. Many looking around might have wondered, why did Jesus not reprove this woman for touching him, knowing not who she is and what the Mosaic laws said about her? Remember his disciples, as he spoke to the Samaritan woman at the well, they marveled that a Jewish Jesus was speaking to an adulterous Samaritan woman. What if they were there when he asked her for a drink? What would they have done? Hear what the prophet Isaiah says in Isaiah chapter 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Then Matthew supports the point I made. Hear what he says. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill them. Matthew 5 verses 17 tells us, he is the fulfillment of the law. Therefore, he is not subject to them. Allow me to prove my point. If you are aware, tell me any place in the Bible that records that after this woman touched him, he was placed on isolation for 7 days and had to wash his clothes. It does not exist. But this is the Levitical law. When you are touched by a woman with an issue of blood that has been determined to be unclean, you have to be in isolation for 7 days and your garments has to be washed. But we see nothing of this in scriptures after the woman with the issue of blood touched Jesus, because Jesus is not subject to the laws. He is the embodiment of he who fulfilled the laws. Principle number 10. There is power in his presence, his person, and his proclamation, the word. Reach for him in worship. Reach for him in prayers, the word, and in praises. It does not matter the way you choose to touch him, as long as you touch him with a purposeful touch. As long as you touch him according to his protocol. Not that has been set by man, but his protocol. Reach out to him with a purposeful touch that is in alignment with his protocol. There are blessings to be received from a purposeful touch. Jesus is not a respecter of person. He values those equally on the pulpit as those in the pews. He is kind to the ruler as he is kind to those subject to the rulership. He has time for you. He was on his way to a ruler of the synagogue's house named Jairus, for his only daughter laid sick unto death. Yet he took the time to tend to a woman whom society had ostracized, meaning she was seen as unclean, she was detested, she was an outcast. He was on his way to the ruler's house, but he stopped for this woman. Jesus has time for you. Jesus has time for me. He doesn't see you as being insignificant. He has no greater value. He places rather no greater value on a ruler as he places on the subject. He places no greater value on those on the pulpit versus those who sit in the pew. He places no greater value on the rich and the wealthy more than he does the poor. For the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but should have everlasting life. Are you counted as a part of the world? He did not place social status. He did not place a financial status. He says, for God so loved the world. God does not love any more than he loves you. God loves all equally. What we do not understand is, while he loves all of us equally, he does favor some more than the others, because God's favor is not fair. So, God has time for you. God has time for me. He is still in the business of healing. We must get into the Word of God. The Word of God reveals the heart and the mind of God. It shows us who God is. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's unchanging. Go to God. He's waiting for you. He is waiting to hear from you. Go to him with prayers. Go to him in praises. Go to him in the word. He says, command me, yea, the works of my hands, and I shall do it. He says, come, let us reason. He says, plead your cause so you can be justified. We have a gracious God. We have a good God. These are principles that I have just unearthed out of scriptures, just based on this one situation, the woman with the issue of blood. And there are many more. These are just a few that I have lifted out of scriptures. I encourage you, as I encourage myself, that we ought to get into the Word of God so we can know the mind and the heart of God, so we can see how God works. We can know and learn about God's promises, so we can increase our faith, so we can know our role. There is a part that you must play. There is a part that I must play. We have responsibilities. And we cannot just lay our responsibilities to the side and think that God is going to do it all. There are some things that God and God alone will do, and those are what God has deemed that he will do, and he will do it divinely. But then there are those that we have to be co-laborers with Christ. And so we must work in concert. We must work in harmony. We must work harmoniously with God to get to our desired end. Father, how we thank you, we bless you, we praise you. Lord, we worship you, we magnify your name. We thank you because you are a good God. We thank you because you are a merciful God. We thank you because you are kind and gracious. Father, we thank you because the balm of Gilead still works. There's healing, O God, in the name of Jesus. There is healing in the blood of Jesus. Father, we're asking you to encourage us by your Spirit, not to accept sicknesses and diseases as our plight, but that we must do that which is necessary, and you will do for us that which we can't do for ourselves. Father, I pray for everyone under the sound of my voice. Father, whatever issue they're dealing with, whatever sickness they're dealing with, may it be sickness of their minds, O God. May it be sickness of their souls, that is sin. May it be sickness of their bodies, O God. Whatever infirmity they're dealing with, Father, I pray that you will touch them in the name of Jesus. I pray that you will reveal yourself strong and mighty on their behalf in the mighty name of Jesus. I pray that you will visit them, O God. I pray, O God, that the healing balm of Gilead will reach them. Father, I pray that you will touch them. Father, in the midnight hours, that you'll make yourself known to them in the name of Jesus. Father, touch them, O God. Visit them, O God, with your healing power, and touch them from the crowns of their heads to the soles of their feet. In Jesus' mighty precious name, I pray. And all God's people say, amen. If you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you may very well not receive that healing. But there's a greater healing than just your physical body. And it can only be had because you have accepted the gift that God has given us, His Son, Jesus Christ. If you refuse this free gift, you will lift up your eyes in hell. Today is the day. Tomorrow is promised to none. If you want to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you want Him to heal your soul, heal your sick, sinned soul, restore it to its original form, how Adam and Eve were created before they sinned, then say these words after me. Believe in your heart, mix it with faith, and you shall be saved. Dear God, I admit I am a sinner and I need your forgiveness. I believe that Jesus Christ died in my place, paid the penalty for my sins. I am willing right now to turn from my sin and accept Jesus Christ as my personal Savior and Lord. I commit myself to you, Jesus, and ask you to send the Holy Spirit into my life to fill me and take absolute control of me and to help me become the person you intend for me to be. Thank you, Abba Father, for loving me. Thank you for sending Jesus to die in my place. In Jesus' mighty precious name I pray. Amen. If you have just said those words and you have believed every bit of it in your heart, you have now been translated from the kingdom of Satan, the kingdom of darkness, and you have been translated in the kingdom of God's dear Son, Jesus Christ, and you are now indwelled with the Holy Spirit. I encourage you to get into a Bible-believing church. I encourage you to get into the Word of God and to get the Word of God into you. I encourage you to start calling on the Holy Spirit. He's our paraclete, meaning one that walks alongside. He is your teacher, your encourager, your mentor, your light, your guide. Ask Him to teach you. I guarantee you, if the Holy Spirit teaches you, you will be taught error-proof. I will repeat that. I guarantee you, if the Holy Spirit teaches you, you will be taught error-proof, and you will be taught with understanding. Folks, this is Jen Harvey from the Bible Says International Ministries with this segment of the Hour of Power. Until we meet next week, same place, same time, may the peace, the presence, the power, the purpose, the protection, the provision, the providence and promises of God rest and abide permanently with you, is my prayer. In Jesus' name, beloved, I love you. Go forth and thrive.
And I sent my word, and I healed your disease. I am the Lord, your healer. This is His word, His promise. Sing it. I am the God, yes, that healeth thee. I am the Lord, your healer. I sent my word. I sent my word, and I healed your disease. I am the Lord.
He did it for her. He certainly can do it for you. But you must go to Him. You must ask God to heal you of your diseases. Not only those that are physical, but those who are also spiritual and emotional. He could do it. He could do it if he so chooses. And if he chooses not to, remember that our God is a sovereign God. Amen. Amen.
And he promised in his word that he is a God who heals. And although you may have questions, but why this person?